I just wanted to raise one issue that I know we had the opportunity to speak separately about, but one that continues to concern me. Obviously, I think it's been since the 11-12 budget year that we brought new projects into Part A for PlanCon. And I think there's been almost no money appropriated. I think one year we may have put $10 million in into PlanCon. Obviously, this is a line that at one point was about $350 million appropriation. And for decisions, the legislature has largely driven the ship on a pretty large bonding scheme to fund PlanCon. And again, that's not to be critical of PlanCon. I think these are needs that have to be met. But I'm continued to be concerned about the way we're doing it. Obviously, there's going to be a huge cost to using bonding for this purpose, and there doesn't necessarily seem to be a long-term consensus on how we're going to get back to, on an annualized basis, funding new construction. I just wondered if there's any conversation about a moratorium for next year. Obviously, that is not a forward-thinking way to do it, but it does have the annualized basis of getting us through a budget year. But I continue to be concerned about structural issues like that. Obviously, you're looking at approximately $250, maybe $300 million in annualized debt service now, where before we were paying about $300 million a year for current year projects. Any thought on any of those topics?
So, Mr. Chairman, we've not engaged in that conversation around another moratorium or bond issuance. I think more so on the on issues of PlanCon, we've been providing technical support and acting in the position of staff, so to speak. So, but we've been providing the same information to all parties involved as well.
I would just wrap up on the PlanCon point by saying we're going to probably hit our $2.5 billion statutory limit, which we created when we went down this issue of bonding for PlanCon. And I think we need to be forward thinking about the structural challenges and the limitations that are within the legislature. These issues are very problematic for a lot of us who don't want to see funds that are intended for educating kids going to pay debt service because the legislature wasn't able to deal with current year appropriations. That continues to cannibalize education dollars in favor of long-term legacy costs, and I think that is a road that we're seeing in the pension context has not been favorable, and I don't want to see us married to this as a long-term solution. If I could, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the issue of the lawsuit, and I know Representative Schweier, and he speaks eloquently about the topic. He's in one of those districts. I represent one of those districts, but I also represent two, in the grand scheme of things, relatively well-to-do suburban Montgomery County districts, but I also represent the community of Norristown, which has a high local tax effort, but combined with a demographic that requires a much higher local tax support, and the consequence of inequity. I was reading through some of the literature about the ongoing lawsuit and talking about the disparity among Pennsylvania schools, and I can see it within my own legislative district. And I can't help but think, and I don't have a question, but I just can't help but think, if we had a school district, within one school district, if they had regionalized their district and put all of the tax effort on one part of the district, and that was the poorest part of the district, and it happened to be also largely a minority community, and conversely, the other half of the district was largely more affluent and could do with less tax effort, and happened to be less racially diverse, I can't imagine there wouldn't be a lawsuit in about 30 seconds if a district was doing that within the confines of a single district. But in my part of Montgomery County, you can cross Township Line Road, and because there's an artificial division of a school district, somehow it's acceptable that there are radically different levels of funding, radically different efforts of local tax support that's required. This is much like we've talked about the moral component of the minimum wage increase. There is a moral issue that we have schools that are completely in different worlds, and yet are one township line road, one school district away. And I see it in my own legislative district. I don't ask for an answer because I realize there is litigation ongoing on this very topic. But it is one that is as clear as black and white to many of us, and there is a moral equation to it and a component to it, and it needs to be addressed. Thank you, Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.